temperature, right? It increases the temperature and it might chip or it might affect. It happens, right? It happens several times. So, for that, we have a demo rolled up. That's basically a temperature sensor. We monitor the temperature of that room wherever they installed the transformer, high-end transformer, right? We monitor the temperature. If anything going beyond certain limit, then it router to this IoT platform, right? Then IoT platform can do this. So this is the one. And today I'm going to talk about this one. Appropriately you connect it here, and then you have the device over here. So let me walk you through that. Enable thing. Hopefully this thing should work here. Okay, so let me reset my panel here. So I will take you to my own dashboard, my electricity bill, you will see that some of the analytics, what really an IoT is enabling me, right? Whether I use it or not use it, but there's a really lot of data to get it, when I really look into my own portal here, right? So this is my PG&E who is supplying the electricity and the gas to us. So I'm just opening up here. Let's see here. So now it's a lot of information on the website. There's information coming to me. They did it. So I'll just upload this one. So this is my electricity, the month-to-month bill. So I go to my energy uses details. Now, how much is I use the energy, right? It's all coming from the data, right? IoT data only, right? It's not going to. See, this is my, energy uses. I have a 24 kilowatt is the limit. And then, of course, the shown graph is a maximum here. And you see from April 24th to May 28th, 2020, that's May 28th, is the billing cycle, right? I have every month billing May 28th, they start billing it, and then I have this cycle here, right? How much I have get. See, I have got electricity. This is my electricity stick, right? And then it gives me weather also. You see, temperature, how much temperature is that? 68 degrees is the maximum, humidity 84, and less temperature is, lower temperature is a 55 degree Fahrenheit, and everything comes in Fahrenheit here. So this is how this graph goes here. And now I can see month-wise also. Let's see the year-wise view, right? I can see my year-wise view here. And, it starts in this, April, May. So it comes up to the April. As you can see this February, the peak. I have invested, it's about 986 kilowatt. Whereas in other one, 661 kilowatt. Don't worry about the numbers, numbers. It doesn't, tally with the Indian rates, but here, it's a 33 cents per kilowatt in the daytime, and the night, if you power on any equipment, say from night 11 p.m. to morning 6 a.m., the tariff is about, 8 cents or 8 cents per kilowatt. Whereas in the daytime, they charge $33. That's why, you know, any electric car, I used to have that. So any electric car, you know, you plug in the night, right? So that your electricity consumption is less. That any autonomous vehicle, you know, we charge it in the night and morning we come back and do that. Even household appliances, you cannot do that, but that's the practice. They say that you power it on in the night. But nighttime, it makes nice, right? Your washing machine or, you know, dryer, if you want to put it on. So this is the, you know, some kind of an ad stick coming up, and it's every month it's get updated here. And then I have the natural gas also, right? The gas also comes to my home from this company. So then I get these ad stick here, right? So all the aspects here, it comes here. See how much I have energy, which is 21 units. And then you see that. So as you can notice here, no, it's also not that simple data, right? As you see, February is the peak for me here, 986. And March also, it was a peak, 1001 or so. January. And then March also, it is peak here. The reason here is that when COVID happened, we all started working from home, right? Me, my wife, and we had some guests, you know, she also started working from here. And my son, who is in the high school, he also worked from home. And then we switch on the AC or we switch on the heater. You know, everything is on, right? That's why you see the February bill is with 986 kilowatt. Other than that, you know, it is less over here. So that's how it tells you. Now, this is ad stick coming directly from your electricity company. And then similar homes, normally they used to give it, but now they stopped it. They also give me some kind of an analytics here, no data available. They give me some data. Okay, how much your neighbor is spending, how much your next door is spending, how much they are spending, and what is the relative data to that, you know? I can compare with the district, I can compare with the talukas, I mean the counties, I can also compare with the state, you know. They really can get this. How they're doing it? Because everything is a device connected, right? My smart meter is connected. Every 3 hours, they're taking my reading and displaying these aspects. So that's how, and now we'll see how we can get our data, this one, right? So now let's see role of what is the electricity supplier. You know, I just put the electricity supplier here. It's electricity as well as the gas supplier, but it's applied to them. Effectively balance loads and reduce the power outages. That's their responsibility. And then streamline the energy distributions through more accurate forecasting. Enable dynamic pricing by rising or lowering costs based on the real-time demand. You know, they have to really do that demand. In fact, one good thing happened COVID-19 is that most of the electricity companies over here, I'm sure this is happening over there also, they have actually leaving some leverages or some kind of an discounted structure for the household, you know, those who lost their jobs or they have not able to get paid, you know, especially on the travel industry and then even hotel industry. And supportive industry, you know, they all got affected. You know, they're all, you know, lowering the prices for them, you know. It's no question asked. As long as they tell them that, you know, this is what it happened, the costs are reduced. And the government also giving some stimulus package, right? So all this data, you know, it's not coming just by them. The data is helping during the COVID-19 situation that how we can, utilize the stimulus package as well. And providing helpful and detailed feedback on energy consumption, precise real-time data and their smart meter, right? That's what it's happening to me every time I get my data. Improving transparency on monthly energy bills through offering more pricing based on usage and enabling them adjust their habits based on the information on their electric bills. So we can just give them the ad stick. I keep getting the informations, you know, they used to get it. I don't know that compared to my home other neighbor, how I'm doing it, you know. So now, this is in another platform, IoT platform, a company called Silverlink, they have created. It's now part of, I think somebody has acquired this company. So what they have done is they have created an IoT platform, which basically connecting to all the vendors, you know, who are, advanced metering, who are manufacturing the meter, who are making the demand side management, and then the automation, and then the city infrastructure, right? So all those things, they are managing that. and then connecting to the Silverlink portal. Hope I'm audible there, right?
Yes, you are audible, but there is some background noise of telephone or something.
Somebody was trying to reach me. I just put it on a silent mode. Is there any other background noise coming from my side?
No, sir. Please carry on.
Okay. No, please, tell me if my voice is not clear.
Yes, sir. Definitely. If anything, I will inform you.
Okay. Thank you. So far, so good, right? You are able to see my slides and my data analytics and all, right? Yeah? Okay. All right. So this is the another, from IEEE, my colleague has taken this data. So basically, what he's done is that he just take the, what is the role of the smart meters in the energy management systems, So when he was doing the research, then he found this, prime data capture. 65% is for the capturing the data. And then 12% is that for the software industry, and 10% is for the transmissions, and then the 10% is the central government. Okay, now let's move on to our main topic, right? I mean, what the IoT as an engineer, what we can do as a faculty or as a research team, how we can help the community or how we can help the consumers to get into that. So this is a basic a block diagram of IoT enabled smart meter monitoring. Actually, I would say smart meter monitoring. I have another block diagram on the smart meter, how we can demonstrate the smart meter on that. So we have the load, then we cannot directly connect to the load. We just shown that the current sensor, which actually draws the current, because we know the voltage. If you know the current at some point, then V into I is equal to your watt, right? Then you can calculate in the watts first, and then we go on to the kilowatt and megawatt, depending upon the where you are, right? At home, we may require kilowatt. In the power stations, you may be requiring the megawatt. So then, since as you know, this is going to be an analog, then we need to have an A to D converter. We are converting that to an ADC converter, and that connects to a Raspberry Pi. I just shown the Raspberry Pi board, and then we have you have a registers there. Registers is nothing but your GPIO pins that are there, and then you have connecting to the server. And once you have the server HTTP connections, then admin, user, everything come on there, and you have not many customers to them. This is the basic block diagram which you will see it in our demo over here. And this one is some kind of an enhanced diagram. We have the mains, so then many of you recognize that there's a current sensor and A to D converter, which is adjusted to a typical MP3008 from the analog devices. And then we have the Raspberry Pi, and then you have the cloud platform, right? Many of you recognize this board. I also shown here, on the top, let me take again pen here. I also shown the so here actually you see here. This portion, as you recognize, this is basically an current source, right? So sometimes what happened, in fact, we were trying to get a demo based on this current sensor. Now, we have some current sensor. It was not working, We wanted to go to the market and get it, but all the markets are down. Now we need to order it online. So then what we have done is that we just shown in current source here, right? We're generating the current. You can generate it from the voltage, right? You can just draw two resistors, a voltage divider, and show it as a current sensor and give it to analog device converter. It's going to be an ideal current, but by changing the resistors or by changing this, this R component over here, you can always get the variable current here, right? So we thought we'll show it, but we have some other demo. Yeah, I'm sure you will like it, So this is the kind of a current source. That current source inputs A to D and then Raspberry Pi. And then we have the cloud platform here. Okay, this is very interesting. I really like this whole diagram. You know, if any one of you want to do any smart metering yourself, this is how it works actually. I mean, after that, there are a lot of things might have come. So let me walk you through some of the components. I'm sure electrical engineers and electronic engineers or instrumentation engineers, they will appreciate it. Computer science, basically you will probably start realizing, probably later than this, right? When you connect this through your RF or the ZigBee, you start realizing that how important is the data, you know? So this is, I have taken it again courtesy from the NXP Technologies. I was going through their application note that how smart meter really works, right? How, what is there inside? You know, I wanted to break it and see that what is that works. Then I found that this is how it works actually. So we have mains is coming up. So 110 volts or the 230 volts. Here we use the 110 volts. In US is a 60 hertz. And there it is in India, it's 230 volts, 50 hertz, right? So then we have, neutral here. And then there is a voltage divider. And we sense the voltage. We sense the V here. And we sense the current also here, right? We sense the I over here. And then we are sensing the voltage here. And then we have, there is a programmable gain amplifier. Basically, we need to, program the output of the amplifier depending upon the feedback, right? Because, there are a lot of AC components will be there. And several times you'll see the ripple or the surges, when you connect any AC. DC is very simple, right? I remember that designing an SMPS or a switch mode power supply is much tougher than designing your pulse code modulator or any other pulse side, right? Because it's digital, you know the status, what is happening. It's 3.3 volts or 3.2 volts above, it's TTL high, right? Below that is TTL low or zero. So you know that status. But in AC, so many harmonics it comes, right? That's why, I always, respect those who are on the analog side, right? So you've got so many harmonics on the positive side, harmonics on the negative side. They have to really deal with the each harmonics and each component. So you have a, gain amplifier, which basically you can program it. And then we have a sigma delta channel. Basically, this is basically how you can convert that into a digital format, like something like your A2D converter. We have a sigma delta channel here. And convert your voltage or current sensing, we're sensing the current into an ARM. Actually, they have used the ARM M40. I believe it is ARM 7, now it's ARM 9 based. Those of you who know the ARM, ARM is a microcontroller family where Raspberry Pi also is born from the ARM, right? So it's a microcontroller family. They make the intellectual property. Per se, they don't make any, integrated chipsets. They make the IP and license to several companies like ST Microelectronics, Motorola, NXP, then Qualcomm. They've got 100+ licenses, right? So then you have the ARM metrology chip, what they call KM3X256, which is operating at 75 megahertz. And then, then they have the control panel, control the button. They've got a lot of panel. They can control it through GPIO. They have the upper cover, they can monitor these signals. And lower cover, again, you can program it, whatever lower cover, everything is coming. Yeah. So one good thing is a temperature detect, temperature detect here. So basically, anything happen inside the circuit or outside the circuit or on the PCB, when you make the PCB, they have to detect the temperature and send to that, to the ARM, the processor here, right? This is your main microcontroller here, right? So you have to send the information that, hey, I'm having the, trouble. Now you stop the operations or the sleep mode, go into the sleep mode, then send that information to the, person in the cloud, what is happening on the operation side, right? So then we have the tilt sensor also, Why the tilt sensor? I was just thinking, what is the tilt sensor inside, So tilt sensor is nothing but if somebody tamper the meter, right? These are all sealed, right? I mean, it is quite obvious it will happen, right? You you package it and send it, a meter or diagram what I shown, you know, somebody can really tamper it, right? So if it is tampered, then you send an alarm or some kind of an indication that somebody has tampered the meter or a smart meter, you cannot take the reading, right? Somebody has reset the reading, now you cannot. That's why they have a tilt sensor inside that smart meter. And then we have a real-time clock. So the real-time clock is basically what they say is that over the period of time, over a period of 1 year, it's about 60 minutes or so, the time it changes, I believe, because of all these components. So we need to adjust that timings over there, right? We need to, that's why the real-time clock is there. You adjust based on the real-time, because otherwise the precision of the building goes wrong, right? If you are not adjusting with the real-time, then the precision of the building, somebody is asking me the time stamping, right? And tariff also, right? They schedule the tariff, night one rate and morning one rate, afternoon one rate, summer one rate, winter one rate, so that they have to have this real-time operations on that. And then we have a E-square PROM here, electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. So this one, you know, you can program your billing structure, right? Every year, every 6 months, we keep changing, right? We keep changing the billing pattern, right? So we can program it in a PROM. You can always change that PROM. Now everything is happening online, right? I remember that when I was in undergraduate, so we used to have an 8086. Many of you have undergone, my colleagues here, our senior professor. So you have this 8086 or 80286, that development board, ZAT board, right? We used to have an E-square PROM and then you program it and do it. But nowadays, everything is on the fly. You know, you don't have to really change the EPROM. Yeah, as you know, the tools have come. You can just log into that particular system. You can change the programming stuff. So this one is, you can change the tariff. You can change any information you want to change it. You can change that aspect. You've got the EPROM here. And then you have the infrared readout, right? Now, I remember when the earlier, the person used to come with an infrared information just to read the reading from infrared. And he doesn't want even read what is there on this LCD, right? There's an LCD also here, right? So there is an infrared one. So using the infrared beam, we just beam it on that and then he take the readings and go, right? He used to do that. I remember my next door, you know, basically he has to cross the fence, right? Or he has to go some other road. So what he has done, he found a kind of a hole in the fence. Through that hole, he used to protect that infrared beam and then get that reading and then, you know, take it down and make it a billing, right? They'll do it a billing. But nowadays, everything is connected through wireless, you know. It doesn't have to come. Nobody comes to my home. Even in India, some of the cities, I'm sure you're experiencing that. So then you have the power supply, SMPS, and then 3.3 volts, and then you have frequency of 32 kilohertz to adjust the timing over here. So, and then we have the output here, right? Everything is going through an I2C or a serial communication bus. So here we have a, you know, RF output. This is where it gets transmitted, right? So we get the transmitted from output, and then, you know, you can take it to the router, what I showed in modules, right? So connect it from there. So this is how a smart meter works. Many of the companies, especially NXP, then ST Microelectronics also have this kind of case. Motorola used to have it. Then Qualcomm, they also having this kind of a thing. And many of the programming chips from the ARM, they have this one. So this is again, thanks to NXP. These are some of the smart grid and metering references design. It's available, you know, if you want to do any of the project, these are all available. It's given to you. You can take that to your productions, and then you can start building a prototype. And any of you are doing any research, you can take this. You know, one could be, you know, connectivity. They have 802.15 Zigbee MC132X. You can take this part, and then the flow is, you can have the water meter, gas meter, heat meter, and then you have the single phase, right? Low cost meter. Different kind of a single phase, different frequencies, you have that. And three phase, actually I have not explained here, three phase is, it's good actually, but very, very complex, right? You got three different phase, red channel, B and green, and then neutral. it's become real complicated. You have to really go and practice it. For these explanations, I have given this one. So now I see some messages here. Maybe I'll stop here and I'll pause here. Maybe take any questions from any audience, or let me just cross check on the logistic front. So I see some chat here. Any question from anybody? So I see clear then. Okay. Okay, I have some question here. Let me take it. First of all, let me stop the video here so that I don't take the much bandwidth here. I didn't realize that. And all right, so I have some questions here. Okay, there's one question. There is a setup to set up IoT lab in institute. What else you need? Yes, that's a good question. I'm going to show you some components. You know, what are the things you need to set up in IoT? Please bear with me, and I'll show some demo there. And how is this done in India? So to set up an institute, okay. How is this done in India? So this one is the smart meter reading. If I understand correctly, the question from Ravi is that how is this done in India? So maybe you're talking about the smart meter. I'm not sure. I get a mixed feedback. You know, I was doing research, you know, since I was going to do this topic, then I get a mixed feedback. I don't know how it is done in India. You know, I need to do research on that. Smart metering in India. Okay, and then we have a question. So, yeah, I guess what is the cost of typical smart meter? Actually, you know, I never go and purchase the smart meter. It is a part of my electricity company or the PG&E company. I really go and research it. How much it costs, I don't know. I don't know whether they sell it individually also, because it will be sold to the companies, right? But I can check up. If you need it, I can check up. Because normally, it's a part of my package, right? The installations, all the routing they do that. Okay, in India, GAIL is supplying gas through pipeline from household side now. How can we concept IoT to reduce our gas bill? Yeah, we could definitely do that, as long as you have the gas pipe, which the GAIL is supplying through the pipe. You can have a tapping from that meter itself, right? Meter will have some kind of an connections, right? You can connect it. Or I am going to show one concept, which is the gas sensor. You know, you can connect the gas sensor. It actually detects the gas and send that information to the thing. But please try it out with a competitive authority, because gas and electricity is such a thing that we always need to have a competitive authority in front of, you know. We don't want to experiment without any of their presence, right? Even though I am doing a lot of things on this IoT, but somebody has to be there, because once you open up any gas thing, it's very difficult, right? It's very unsafe. So please do it in front of any competitive authority. Can we have you the schematic of that, if you have it? Which one? I don't know. Can we have us the schematic? I don't know. So then we have the... Yeah, many of times sensor gets affected with temperature in industrial plot. Yes, absolutely right. So you will... you will have some temperature. effect. So this is how IoT will come in picture, right? You can always, you know, connect the temperature, set the temperature value in your programming, whatever programming you're using, whether you're using the Python programming, whether you're using Java, you can always, you know, program it and connect that. Some current and voltage sensor with works on high temperature. Yeah, I have some data sheet. I'm going to suggest that what the current and voltage sensor with the works on the high temperature. Yeah, sure. So then we have the question. Okay, in Duliajan, Assam also comes piped. Yes, I remember that. So there also we can connect to this sensor meter. Okay. Now, how do you simulate smart metering system? Actually, you can take some of this NXP. They have the simulation tool. You know, instead of you integrating the ARM processor or ARM thing, you can take some simulation and then you can use that. So, what is gateway? Gateway is nothing but you know, you are connecting your all the sensor, all the inputs from the metering. Let me take out that here. Somebody asked me for the sensor. What is the gateway here? So, as you can see here, you know, this is the gateway. Gateway is nothing but it connects your the local or public area networking to the gateway. You know, it is something like, I would say, you know, your internet, right? You have internet in the university or in the college or in the school. You have one gateway, which all your Ethernet port or all the Wi-Fi port connect to one.
Yeah, man.
So, yeah, let me continue. They're all great questions, but, you know, I will take questions at the end also. But, you know, probably I'll take another pause, then we can take the questions. So, now then, we have talk about this this one. Now let's you know, move on to what's the Internet of Thing here, right? What's the IoT here? So I switch off my video. Hopefully, you know, we'll save some bandwidth here. So definitely, whenever I do the class, I would prefer to have an eye-to-eye connections, at least through video. But, you know, since the bandwidth is a challenge, you know, I think we can talk when we have the question and answer session. So, Internet of Thing, you know, what is the definitions? You know, when you say the IoT, there are a number of definition comes to our mind, right? People say it's connecting sensor to the microcontroller. Someone say, you know, microcontroller to the cloud. Someone says connecting to the gateway. So, you know, actually coming from an electrical or an electronics background, IoT is not a new to us, right? Those who are in the electronics background or communication background, because this embedded electronics is there for last 30 years, right? Embedded electronics is not just yesterday, right? We have been doing this IoT or the sensor connecting to an embedded electronics, right? We used to program in embedded C or C programming. Now Python is becoming very popular. The only thing what it added is the connectivity and the cloud, right? So we have added these two components more so on the cloud. That becomes an Internet of Thing, right? So, and over the last 5 years or 6 years, a lot of things have improved, right? In terms of the connections, in terms of the connecting your any devices. As you know that a smartphone is now almost like a, you know, is like a supercomputer of 90s, they said, right? It's so powerful. It has got the CPU, it has got the memory, which is equivalent to a supercomputer in early 90s, what you used to get, you know. So that's there. And speed, right? Speed, we used to have 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G. Now we are into 5G era, right? It's so much is happening. So obviously, you know, it's motivating a lot of devices to be connected, a lot of things to be connected to the IT side, right? So for the definition, what I did is, just to be very unbiased, I took the definition from IEEE, right? This is the link, you get it. So I have taken it from the IEEE. So what it says is basically, you know, it's Internet of Things is a self-configuring and adaptive system consisting of a network of sensors and smart objects whose purpose is to interconnect all things, including everyday and industrial objects, in such a way as to make them intelligent, programmable, and more capable of interacting with humans. I always read this, you know, whenever I do my IoT, first day, my second or third slide will be this after I share the syllabus. So this one is, see the beauty of this definition, right? It connects everything there. It connects your sensor, smart objects, connects human being, and it's programmable, right? So everything they have derived this from the IEEE, right? So now let's see what are the main components of IoT. We have identify what the need there, what the sensors is there, what actuators is there, and then you predict, right? You are predicting that what exactly you are looking for it, okay? And then the analyzing it, right? These are the three basic characteristics of your IoT systems, right? You are identifying, predicting what you want, and then analyzing it. That's more important, right? You are analyzing it, all the data. Like earlier I demonstrated, right, my EG&D or the electricity and gas bill. I can really analyze it, you know. And really that gives me a good input, right? Oh my God, I'm spending so much of money every month. How can I cut it down? How can I make my other apertures, you know, cut it down? So those are comes in the analyzing. So this is just a history or the roadmap of IoT. You know, 69 internet emerges, you know, internet actually came. Those who are know in 69 or you might have studied, there's a defense at ARPANET. They used to have only for the defense, right? It used to be in, based on Unix, actually, Unix machines, right? That time Unix was very, very structured, very, even now today also, right? They're all very ruggedized and very secured, right? The military used to use that. And then TCP/IP came in picture. Then we have 1990, a thing is born. Actually, as per the history, they say that the first IoT device was basically a toaster, right? You basically in Stanford University, someone wanted to toast their bread in the office, and they went to the kitchen area or cafeteria area. They just put the bread, and then they connected to an Ethernet. From Ethernet, they connected to the PC. And they went to the Xerox machine or taking some other art to the laptop. Their laptop was not their desktop. And then, they used to get some kind of an internal message, right? TCP/IP message through Ethernet. Hey, your toaster is ready. Then you go back and eat it. You know, that's the internet, I think they said. The first thing was born there. So, 99, it officially got a name. Kevin Austin from MIT, he actually recognize this IoT through this IoT ID center. Then you have the laboratory. He made this door opener or the RFID-based enabled devices to open up. And 2005, it got a, IPSO name, which is basically, Internet Protocol for the Smart Object. So, what it does is it's a kind of a standard. They created a lot of IoT standards, and then you can connect the devices to that aspect. And 2008, Cisco has got a system keeping account of number of connections you connect to their backend, right? So they started counting that. If you happen to come to in San Jose, Cisco, in California area, they have a system where they keep track of counting how many devices getting connected to their backhaul, right? They have a data center. They are keeping a track, All those 20 billion or 25 billion, when we talk, it's just that it's not coming, right? It is coming. Somebody is keeping a monitor of that. And then 2011, IPv6 came. Actually, to the interest of time, I'm not covering up IPv4 and IPv6. It's a big subject. IPv6 introduced in 2011, we realized that IPv4 has got only 32 bits. Most of you must have been practicing that. which is 2 to the power of 32, only so many, you know, devices I can address. Whereas in IPv6, it has got 128 bits, right? 2 to the power of 128 bits, I can address it. And you know, the introduced IPv6 has introduced that, motivated the IoT again, because a lot of devices could be connected. And 2013, then Google rises the glass, they came up with the glass, and then 2014, Apple started on the IoT, then came the Alexa, Google Assistant, Apple Siri. So a lot of things get added to whole this internet wagon, right? Many people started coming up with their own devices, which connected the internet. So this is the Gartner hype, you know. Normally I you know, follow up every September or so, they announced this graph. You know, as you can see that, you know, everything is going up, and now we are, this 5G is a very big way here, right? So obviously, you know, I can imagine that there's so much of IT, so many of connected things happening. So 5G is the peak of inflated expectations, you know? So I would highly recommend, if you are doing any research paper or anything, you refer this Gartner hype cycle. You get at least, it's predominantly very industry recognized here. We follow that. So we start the any abstract or opening statement in our paper that this is what is required. This is the technology and how we can do that in any paper. So this is in another slide, which basically, you know, gives you the Internet of Things number of devices. Okay, so we have as you see here, 2003, things used to be lesser than the people, right? Whereas now today, it's estimated, of course, already there now. So the number of devices are almost 3 or 4 times than you know, the existing human being. So definitely the 50 billion devices, 7.3 or 7.6 is the population of the world. So 50 billion, yes, it's going to happen. Now I don't have this one. Probably I'll wait till September. Gartner will announce that how many devices are getting computers. So it is happening there. And then on the right-hand corner, this one, this graph, you know, few of you may not have seen this field, right? So this one is, it used to be only the PC area, right? We never used to have any internet. We never used to have any connected devices there in 95. We used to have a fixed desktop and a fixed hard disk, right? 670 MB means it was a great thing that time, right? If you ask a new generation or my son, 670 MB, wow, that's nothing, you know? You get 2 GB of RAM itself in the phone, right? So, and then we have bring your own devices. In 2000, we have to bring your own devices, means your mobile phones and all. So, and then the Internet of Things came in 2011, it becoming very popular here. So, that Internet of Things, it started here, and now Cisco is naming it as Internet of Everything, right? The definition of that one. So, that's how the evaluation, like fixed computing, bring your own device, Internet of Things, and Internet of Everything. Right. So just to give that, and this is, I just skip that, is all marketing data. Somebody is interested, is all marketing, you know, you can go through that in a leisure time. What's the number of millions dollar and number of devices that you can connect? Okay, so now and then this is the phone. Phone is an internet device, right? There's so many sensors connected to that. In fact, you know, now I can have a Bluetooth to my smart meter, what we're talking, then I can get it on my phone, or the app itself is an app, actually, you know, the electricity company, they give me the app, I can connect to that. So phone has got several sensors to that. So, there's some background noise, I'm sorry. Is it coming from me? There's some background noise.
Yeah, there is a background noise.
I don't know if it's coming from me or I don't know.
Now it has gone.
Yeah, it is gone. I just don't have anything except for fan here.
No. It may be from some other.
Yeah. Okay. So then we have several sensors to that, light, microphone, camera, gyroscope, accelerometer, barometer. So we have so many things. The reason I'm showing is that phone is becoming a very, very important tool for connecting your device or displaying your device itself. So this is just to going into the Indian market. I just asked my colleagues to get me the data earlier. We were delivering a lecture at NIT Warangal. I was there last year, November. And then at NIT Agartala also, we were delivering the half day or one session. It was a part of the GAN program. Actually, I visited at least 4 times for the GAN program. I also take some data from the from Indian perspective, how it's happening. So this is that one, investment made in since 24. And then we have utilities and manufacturing, IoT firms in India, and how many startups are there. This is more towards an entrepreneur, right? Because as I was told, the GAN program from MHRD is a part of startups, then city, municipality, and faculty, research, student, right? So I just to give them some startup company were also there, just to give them what is market share over in India. Okay, now let's move on to that. How we can build an IoT end-to-end system. So, okay, now we have everything. Now, how do I can build the systems? So, how I can build is, first of all, we need to have a concept in paper, right? Like somebody is asking me the question. Somebody was really greatly, they were telling me that we can have, some kind of a project for the Gale or whoever is supplying the gas, right? Already they may be having it. You write the concept, whatever concept you have, and then write the block diagram. So when I say block diagram, something like MXP example I shown earlier, you can write the Okay. And there is a schematic. You you don't have to draw the schematic. All the parts are available. I'm going to show that part there. And then the bill of material, you can create. One has to create what components you need for the IoT, right? You cannot just buy that bill of material. So you have to create the bill of material. And so this is the overall picture. You are developing the prototypes. Right. So actually this slide should have been come earlier. Okay. So the sixth step is that field testing. Test it for 3 to 6 months and then the beta version. You test it for the beta and then the production and then release and documentation. So documentation is also very important, right? You have to create those aspects what we needed so that next batch of students or next batch of project members can take it. So in short, I put this one assembling, then writing the device driver software, writing APIs, and then client integration based on the API. We are going to show you in the part of this first half and my second session, we will show you some really how we can we can show some examples on the board itself, right? So what are the different hardware platforms? As all of you know, Raspberry Pi 3 and then we have it has got the 4 ARM processors, then it has the memory, then there's a clock, then connection, it has got the Wi-Fi, Ethernet, and then Bluetooth. And Arduino Uno, most of you are familiar with the Arduino Uno. So it has the digital and analog I/O. So we will show some demo based on this open source platform. See, this has got the ATMEG 328, then 2 KB RAM, then clock, connections, no Wi-Fi and all. So I'm not going to go through this. And then this is a Node MCU, which has the ESP8266, 128 KB of RAM, SRAM, and then the clock at 80 MHz, and it has got the Wi-Fi. This is a very low-cost IoT platform. You can connect any of your smart meter to this device and evaluate your initial stage. And then when you want to go for a production, you can give to some companies, they can take it for them. Okay, now this is the interesting part here, which basically in the virtual lab, we are going to show this. So what I have learned when I was teaching, as in the introductory question, I'm partly I'm university and partly on my entity, I'm co-founder of companies. Then we realized at the university that, okay, now, you know, there are so much of, you know, sensors, hardware, and then the components, district components we have to give to the student, right? So that's why we built an multifunctional IoT development kit where students and researchers can use it, right? So for example, you will be recognizing this is a Raspberry Pi board and this is an Arduino board, right? This is an Arduino board and this is your Raspberry Pi board. So then it has different sensors here, right? This one has got the temperature and humidity, and we have a light sensor, and then we have the proximity sensor here, gas sensor. Somebody asked me for the gas, so the gas sensor here, and then we have the moisture. Actually, you want to connect the moisture, right? We have the moisture sensor, and there is a Bluetooth. Basically, if you want to connect this device to the Bluetooth, you know, you can connect to this or you can connect to the Raspberry Pi board, right? So it's already wired there. You don't have to do that. Okay. And this has got the real-time clock, RTC, real-time clock. If, for example, we checked, right? You want to adjust the time based on the, you know, what event. You can always adjust it. We have a crystal. I don't remember what is the frequency of the crystal. It's already built there. And then we have a SPI port here. And then switches, right? We can demonstrate. Student can do some kind of an, you know, project using this one, right? You have a matrix switch matrix here. You can do that. And there are some set of LEDs. You can use it for, you know, triggering the LEDs. One example is that one of the students, they did a smart city called smart light, right? They want to light all these four as a smart street light, like 1, 2, 3, 4. They're lighting this light based on certain conditions, right? They have the proximity sensor, right? This is the proximity sensor and this is the LED. So both they form it as a smart city project, right? So this is a smart city project with them. So what they do is that basically whenever there is a person entering there, and if one person means one light, two person means two light, so like that they use this one. And then we have a motor control also here. There is a relay here, solid state relay here. There is a motor control. You can do any of your electrical projects. For example, you want to do the servo motor control. You can do that. And then we have a 7-segment display. And then we also have the LCD display, right? To read all these things, right? You can read it here. As you know, Raspberry Pi doesn't have any monitor, right? You can read everything over and over that. So this is a complete development platform. Let me bring that board here so that we can. So let me at this point. So let me switch on my. Oh, sorry, my video is on. I'm sorry, I didn't notice it. Okay. Probably the bandwidth is good there. So this is the, you know, let me stop my sharing the screen so that I can see my. Okay, so I'm just going to bring the board here so we can see that board once, and then I switch off. So what I'll do is that I'm going to show my
yes, audio.
I'm audible now. Yeah. So this is the board.
Yes, you are.
Am I audible there, please?
Yes, sir. Okay, you are audible.
Thank you. So, I'm just demonstrating this one of the board here. Like I said, you know, we have the Raspberry Pi. I just temporarily installed. This is not a board, actually. Uno board. We need to have something Uno board there. It should be on the other side. And then I have, like I said, you know, we have these are the proximity sensors and different sensors over there. And then we have different switches, then LEDs, and then, you know, everything is built onto this. You can demonstrate, you can make any kind of an IoT project on this for your research project. Somebody asked earlier, right, how I can do all the boards, everything. Like everything is built on this board now. So you don't have to really rely on the sensors. And there are some GPIO pins are open, you know, if you want to program any of the board, any of the pins, then there are some GPIO pins are there, you can always program. So we are going to show some demo on this as well as the other open source hardware. Yeah, and then you have the 7th segment I showed you. Okay. So let me keep this aside. And then before I move on to the next one, I want to show another very quick board in a second. This is another very low print Arduino board, which has got the Wi-Fi built in. Most of few of you might have come across. You know, basically this is an under $30 board. So you have different I/O port here. You can connect the sensors, and it has got a Wi-Fi, right? You can demonstrate this Wi-Fi. If time permits, I'll show this demo also. You can see that how we can connect the temperature sensors through that, and when you connect to the cloud. So at this point of time, I will pause and take any questions and move on to the next session. So we go on to the chat session. Okay. So what is the name of small board? So this is basically, this is called Arduino MK1010. And then lab is good. Okay. Okay, getting on no video. Okay. Okay. And then we have any other questions we have on this? Okay. I'm just taking the question, or please type your question here. I will try to answer whatever I can, and then move on to the next one. Yeah, NodeMCU also, we can do that. There is a question here. There was one question on the cost. Normally, you know, this is the cost wise, I'm not a person. We'll have someone else we'll talk about on the cost. But if you are looking for anything, Bharat and Kishan can help you, and you can take it offline. Amazon, no, it is not available in Amazon, but it is available on what we call central computers here. Or we can, by the way, this board, I think Bharat can, or this Kishan can say. Kishan, this has been approved by this one, no? As of now.
Hello, sir. It's available on the Jam portal. So if anyone wants to see the things, then I can share the link so they can go and see the description.
So yeah, it is that government e-marketing, no? That quote is available. Anybody is interested, Kishan and Bharat, it's available on the Jam portal. So,
excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Any site, website where we can use the simulation, online simulation with Raspberry Pi?
Online simulation for the Raspberry Pi. you want to simulate everything there, right?
Yeah, sir. We want to do IoT based project so that we can go that side, we can approach that side, we can do some experiment whatever we are doing on our mind.
Yeah, I remember that one company they were doing it, but you cannot do the complete IoT. No, you can only, you know, simulate it for the fact that if you need to connect to the cloud, still you have a challenge, right? The simulation mode cannot connect to the cloud, right? Okay. IoT, if you want to do the complete IoT project, you cannot do that. I remember I was talking to Bharat. Bharat, what is that one company you said?
Hello.
Bharat? The company was saying that you simulate those board and then you cannot.
No, actually, for Raspberry Pi, we don't have any simulation. For Arduino, we have the Tinkercad. Tinkercad is also there. Is the
yeah. The only challenge is you cannot connect to the cloud. If I understand correctly, right? Yeah, that's right. Arduino we can use this, but the Raspberry, as Bharat said, there's no simulation card. But my suggestion is that all these IoT projects, you know, you have to do it on a real things, you know. You cannot just simulate the thing and then do it. It's not that expensive, right? You can do the research using the Arduino. I'm not saying that you have to go this board. You can always buy a Raspberry Pi board, simple sensor, and connect it. Even this NTR30, what I've shown, that's also simple. All right. So, any other, we are going to show some example on that. The second half for the next session is going to be a lab, right? How we can connect these kind of a board for the three different applications. And we will show three things, right? One is the Amazon, AWS, how we can connect this sensor to the AWS. And second example will show on ThingSpeak. I don't know if any one of you are aware of the ThingSpeak. ThingSpeak, okay. So we'll show it on the ThingSpeak, and then yeah, I see a lot of yes over there. And I also want to see the poll here. So that, okay. And then then we also want to show the UBI dots. You know, I don't know how many of you use UBI dots. There's another cloud company. We are going to show the three, and goal is that virtual, right? See, under this COVID-19 outbreak, now how do you do virtually, right? Students are sitting remotely, all the faculty are here, head of the department sitting somewhere. So how do you do the remote? We are going to show how you can do a lab remotely, right? So for example, the Raspberry Pi board is there, right? You can log in remotely. I'm going to see Bharat's, PC, and then we can, connect it to the, connect it to the his cloud platform there, right? So, I see there is some Raspberry Pi simulator. Yes, it is, simulator is available. Like I said, I don't know whether you can really connect to the cloud, and I have not seen any simulator connecting to Amazon cloud or connecting to ThingSpeak. Are connecting to Amazon, Microsoft Azure, right? The various platforms out there, right? I've not seen that. Then we have IoT kit available on Amazon. No, it's not available on Amazon or Flipkart. So there's another question: is it compulsory to use Python? And the using the Raspberry Pi. Yeah, it's not compulsory. It is, it's basically you can use your embedded C or you can use the Java version. But again, my experience is that IoT is the real-time devices. If you want to do any projects, I would say you take any use cases, it could be a smart city or a smart meter, and it's just use a real device. And cloud-wise, there are hundreds of companies that are available, right? I've seen them. Paid version, free version. Somebody asked me free version, paid version. You know, it's, but ultimately you are going to create, right? Smart meter, I cannot simulate, right? it has to sense my current, has to sense my voltage. Right? Even though we have a device, we had a chance to connect to some. Right? So my
sir, can I have one line?
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Hello. Yeah, actually, here in the messages, the one link is given Azure samples. Azure samples.github.io. So actually, that is for only for one experiment that we can send only some temperature information to the Azure cloud. Only that, only for that particular purpose, they have given one simulator. That Azure is given that particular simulator, but it is not for the general purpose, or otherwise, we can't do anything, any other things in that. And but in the Raspberry Pi, simulators are not available, but so many controllers are available. Controllers means like we can access the Raspberry Pi remotely, and we can control all the GPIO pins from the mobile device, or otherwise we can access the information and we can control the IO pins. That is possible, but completely simulating is not possible. Yes.
Shivakumar?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, we can take a break.
Sure.
And then we can continue after 15 minutes.
Sure. Fantastic.
Or any other questions you want to take, you can take. Otherwise, we'll break for 15 minutes and you can resume again.
Okay, sure. Absolutely. Yeah, we have some questions. I think some of the questions will be answered when we show the paper. Please hold on to